There'll be solemn services held in the Northern Territory today to mark 80 years since the bombing of Darwin. It was the single largest attack on Australian soil by a foreign power.
Nine's federal politics reporter Fiona Willen is in Darwin. Few of the nation's leaders have travelled there to pay their respects.
Yeah, that's right. They're here to mark this significant moment in Australia's history. So it was on this date, 80 years ago, that the people of Darwin were going about their days when formations of Japanese aircraft appeared in the skies above them and dropped bombs on the harbour and the township. More than 230 people were killed and between 300 and 400 were wounded. So that's why Scott Morrison, Anthony Albanese and the Governor-General David Hurley are here today to pay their respects. They'll each be delivering an address and laying wreaths, but perhaps the most poignant moment of the morning will come just before 10 a.m. That's when we will hear air raid sirens ring out across the harbour as the events of that day are reenacted. Now, the Prime Minister and Opposition Leader have been in the Northern Territory campaigning ahead of this anniversary, but today they'll put aside their political differences. Guys?
The Flying Foxes are in full spirit there at the Esplanade Fee. We appreciate it. It's a really lovely ceremony, that one, every year, and it's quite remarkable when you think about the size of the attack based on...
Yeah, that had such an impact on not just Darwin, but the whole of Australia.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, the 19th of February 1942 will forever be known as the day war came to Australia, with more Japanese bombs dropped on Darwin than on Pearl Harbour 2 months earlier.
Today we remember those who defended our country 80 years ago. Amy Clements reports from the Northern Territory.
In 1942, in Australia's top end, Darwin was a small, sleepy town. As the Japanese exploded into the Pacific, thousands were evacuated. And on February 19, the inevitable occurred.
It was the first attack by a foreign nation on Australian soil.
It was a normal Thursday morning as people made their way to work. But at around 10 o'clock, masses of aircraft were sighted heading towards the town. A priest on Bathurst Island sounded the alarm by radio.
That's probably nothing. It's just the Yanks coming back.
But then the red circles on the wings of the aircraft were spotted. The Japanese had the advantage of a surprise attack. Aged 101, Brian Winspear is one of the few remaining survivors, an air gunner at the time of the attack.
As soon as I saw the sun bleeding off the bombs, I knew they weren't American.
Cleverly, the Japanese attack force approached from the south.
What followed was the howling of 188 planes, the thunder of gunfire, and the crescendo of falling bombs.
We started off by having 12 Lockheed Hudsons and finished up with one.
These were the experienced warriors who had destroyed Pearl Harbor 2 months earlier. The fight raged in a constant roar of explosions and the screams of those hit. And as the Japanese swept in, defenders on the ground met them with fire.
It was every man for himself. I picked up my machine gun and began shooting at him.
One soldier, gunner Darko Hudson, was wearing a towel and his boots and helmet when he came running from the showers. But in the end, he recalls his towel fell off.
When there were reunions and so on, a lot of his mates would give him a lot of stick. They crashed because of the size of your weapon, Darko.
The post office took a direct hit, killing most of the staff. The wharf was split in two.
When they left 20 minutes later or so, Darwin was a smoking ruin.
But the Japanese returned for another raid at midday, this time attacking the airfields.
One of the commanders of the Imperial Japanese Navy said that it was something akin to using a sledgehammer to crack a walnut.
The USS Perry's guns were still blazing as she sunk below water as American servicemen went down with the ship. The wreckage still sits at the bottom of Darwin Harbour.
88 sailors gave their lives here in defence of this harbour. And from that time until today and into the future, we're just the strongest of allies.
There were 9 ships sunk in the harbour and 2 were sunk outside of the harbour.
On our side, 236 men and women died. Many more were wounded. The Japanese lost just 2.
We didn't know then, but we know now, that Japanese forces didn't have an invasion plan for Darwin. What they wanted to do was neutralise Darwin.
After the attack, Darwin Harbour was covered in burning oil. Flames rose into the sky and black smoke rolled into heavy clouds. But it wasn't over. For the next year, the Japanese carried out more than 100 raids across the Northern Territory.
Australia was very much almost overwhelmed in 1942. It was nearly the end of us. I don't think that should be forgotten.
Today, Australia's military past remembered as the day the Japanese Empire turned its attention on a small northern town.
The reenactment is so important to commemorating the event. As soon as that siren goes off, the guys will be running straight to their guns, manning the anti-aircraft weapons.
An unexpected morning attack, labelled Australia's own Pearl Harbor.
Gosh, incredibly powerful to see that vision now so many years later. And we're joined now by war historian and author Matt McLaughlin for more on the impact of the Pacific War on Australia. Thank you for your time, Matt. Look, at the time this happened, these attacks impacted everyone in the country. What can you tell us about that?
Yeah, they certainly did. I mean, 1942 should probably be remembered as the time when Australia felt the most isolated, the most terrified we ever have in our history. Because just imagine the scenario of events. The Japanese attacked Pearl Harbor in December 1941. Singapore fell on the 15th of February. And then on the 19th of February, Japanese bombers attacked Darwin and almost destroyed the entire town. So it was a time when Australia felt that the Japanese must at any minute be going to land on our shores and invade the country. We now know, as it said in that history package you just played, we now know that wasn't the case. But it doesn't change the fact that people were terrified. They thought this was it. They thought the war had come to Australia and this could be the end.
During one of these air attacks, Matt, an Australian soldier shot down a Japanese Zero fighter plane. Can you remind us of the significance of this event, please?
Yeah, this was really interesting. This was the Japanese didn't lose many planes at all in the Darwin raid simply because there weren't many defences in Darwin. But one fairly lucky shot crippled a Japanese plane, and it managed to fly away from Darwin but crash-landed on Melville Island, where the pilot was captured by local Tiwi people and then handed over to the Australian Air Force. And that was the first Japanese prisoner of the Australians during the Second World War. And his name was Hajime Toyoshima, and he was in captivity for a couple of years and obviously quite a prized captive, being the first Japanese person to be captured by the Australians. And then in 1944, he led the Kaura breakout, a huge breakout of Japanese prisoners from a POW camp in the town of Kaura in New South Wales, where about 230 Japanese were killed, including Toyoshima. He was killed in that outbreak. So it's a fascinating story. I've just written a book about the Kaura breakout, and I'm fascinated with the story and how the history of Darwin is so tightly connected with all these other chapters of the war.
How has the attack impacted our defence strategy, so impacting not just this chapter of the war but other wars?
Well, it had a huge effect because none of these things occur in isolation, and the threat that Australia felt led to a big change in our foreign policy. And up until that point, we'd been very closely aligned with the UK, with Great Britain. And obviously, through the First World War, we'd sent troops to fight in Europe. At the start of the Second World War, we thought it was going to be the same. And we had troops in Europe, we had troops in North Africa. But then when the Japanese came so close to home, we needed a complete rethink and we pulled our troops back to Australia. But also it changed our relationship with Britain and our relationship with the world, because we realised that we couldn't rely on Britain and this far-flung Europe to assist us in the Pacific. And we needed someone closer to home who shared our interests. And the obvious partner was the USA. And so there was a shift in about 1942 away from Britain and towards the USA, and that strategic relationship has remained ever since.
And Matt, now that the state borders have reopened, the bombing of Darwin tours are running again. Have you noticed that there's been a strong resurgence in this type of battlefield travel?
Yeah, there absolutely has. I mean, we've seen a resurgence in battlefield travel all across the world, which is great. Obviously, people over the last 2 years have really been longing for that opportunity to get out and walk the ground where these great moments in history occurred. But Darwin in particular has been very strong. Also, the coincidence of it being 80 years this year means that a lot of people have wanted to go up there, and a lot of Australians have a connection to this history. So a lot of Australians have relatives who served or grew up hearing these stories or know that their father or grandfather did something that related to the bombing of Darwin. So it's really wonderful that after 2 years of people being stuck at home and not being able to get out and commemorate these great events, that we're now seeing so many people heading up to Darwin. It's going to be a very special service up there.
Yeah, nice service on the Esplanade as well. Hey, Matt, thanks so much for joining us this morning.